Welcome, listener, to another edition of the Coco and Dolls podcast. We are real people doing real reviews. Oh, yeah. Hi, I'm not Coco.
And I'm not Dolls.
And this edition of the podcast, we're going into the docuseries category as opposed to the ribald, raucous comedy series like we did in the last podcast. Coco, what did we most recently watch?
We most recently watched Trial 4, an 8-part docuseries that was just released on Netflix last week, if you're listening to this in real time, which you should be.
Why aren't you?
Trial 4 is about a young man named Sean Ellis, who in 1993 was arrested and charged with killing a cop in Boston. In 1995, he was tried 3 separate times for this murder. The first 2 trials ended with hung juries. The 3rd trial, he was convicted. He spent the next 20 years in prison until 2015 when an appellate judge ruled that he deserved a new trial because, spoiler alert, there were some crooked cops doing some shenanigans around the initial investigation in the early to mid-90s. And the judge was not a fan of that. So that was in 2015 when the judge ordered the conviction to be thrown out and him to have a 4th trial for this crime. But in December of 2019, just a year ago, the Suffolk County DA, which is part of the Boston legal system, who prosecuted him initially, said they weren't going to try him a 4th time. Not because...
Wait, you just gave the whole thing away.
Oh, that's fine. Not because he's an innocent man, but they took pains to say, we're sure he's still our guy, but we just don't think at this point we could get another conviction. Because apparently all they care about is their conviction rate and not
justice
or truth. So fortunately, Sean Ellis will never spend another day in prison for a crime he didn't commit, but unfortunately he hasn't been completely exonerated. So, Daltz, tell us what you thought of Trial 4, the 8-part docuseries. Each episode was around 50 to 60 minutes.
On Netflix, I thought it was pretty good. I thought there was a little bit of Madeleine McCann in this one. We reviewed the disappearance of Madeleine McCann ages ago, and that was the one that I keep going back to on the death of editing in terms of it was way too long. There was a lot of drone footage, etc. I'm referring to that because I thought there was a little bit of that in this as well. I thought there was some overlap. I think what's happening here when I'm watching these series is that I think some filmmakers are still going into it thinking that people will be watching these like they used to watch TV shows. So in other words, you know, you sit down and you watch it on a Tuesday and then the next one comes out the following Tuesday.
Like Disney is doing with The Mandalorian.
Right.
Each episode of which in this second season we're reviewing. So check that out, listener.
Exactly. So it's almost like the filmmakers are still, you know, they feel the need to review stuff and duplicate coverage in some of these episodes. So I thought it was really good. I thought it was 8 episodes, as you mentioned. I thought it probably could have been about 4 or 5. I mean, if it had been Trial 4 and it had been 4 episodes, maybe that's too neat and tidy. But maybe it could have been 6 episodes. They could have trimmed back on it. But it was really compelling. It was really frustrating to see this Sean Ellis, who, like you said, was a very young guy and just got trapped in the wrong situation, ended up going to jail for, a half of his life.
Right.
And you just can't overstate how awful that is. And we feel that and we see that. And we have a pit bull of a lawyer who's his defense lawyer.
She was great.
She was fantastic. I mean, you mentioned off the top that it looked like Guy Fieri was his lawyer. I thought I couldn't shake that for the rest of the documentary.
The very first shot of, I believe, the first episode was them in the courtroom when the judge is about to overturn his conviction. And you see the defense lawyer just from the back. And she's got that Guy Fieri hair. And she's kind of got the same build as Guy Fieri. And I was like, what? Diners, Drive-Ins, and Dives came to a Boston courtroom.
How awesome would that be? Like, he's in the courtroom and he's like, Judge, I don't know anything about law, but I know these ribs are delicious.
And he's wearing his bowling shirt.
Right.
And his shades.
Licking his fingers.
Right, totally.
So other than the Guy Fieri thing, there's not a lot of humor in this.
Right.
It's pretty serious, pretty straight up. And I thought it was well done. It looked like it was, from your observations, Coco, that it was done by a foreign film crew. So, like, a lot of the production crew was not from the United States. And sometimes it takes that perspective to shine new light on the justice system in the United States. And this kind of thing goes on and on. So that it's not just this particular case, but this is a launching point for the kind of injustice that is going on across the country, where you've got people that are accused of doing crimes they didn't commit and then end up going to jail and spending time in jail for crimes they didn't commit. And the worst case, obviously, being a murder charge. And I thought that was a very interesting perspective and very, very, I had never really seen much of this before. I mean, there are cases like this in Canada when I was growing up, famous cases that I had a little bit of knowledge to, but this one was really in-depth. And I thought it was really good that we got a real inside look at the defense. So the lawyer let the cameras into her office when they were strategizing and when Sean Ellis was coming in there and the defense team and everything like that. So it was really good in that way. I've talked a lot. So if the listener is still there, please stay tuned for Coco's opinion of this.
I knew you were going to say you thought it was too long. I actually...
Did you?
Yeah. I actually appreciated that it was like a very comprehensive look at this case, mm-hmm. because this case is very twisty. Mm-hmm. Like, you have, what was Sean Ellis doing on the night of the murders? Why was he tied to the, you know, murder initially? It was because two of his cousins got murdered and he happened to be interviewed by the cops. And what were these four crooked cops doing? Mm-hmm. And how were these witnesses found? You know, so I liked that it was like a very, very comprehensive look at it. Like, maybe they could have done things in more chronological order. So the introduction of like the dead cop's cell phone, instead of waiting until like episode 6 or 7 mm-hmm. to whip that out, maybe the first episode was just basically, this is what happened on the night the cop died.
Right, right.
You know, and this is like the day after, you know, with everything that went on with that. So mm-hmm. maybe like the cell phone could have been introduced in that episode or episode 2 instead of waiting until closer to the end. So maybe they could have taken like a bit more chronological approach to it, but I didn't mind it. It didn't feel super repetitive to me. Mm-hmm. And the episodes, even though they were all in like just about the hour range, they didn't really drag to me. So I didn't mind the amount of detail they went into. I hate to say that I enjoyed it, because you don't want to say that you enjoyed that some poor innocent man
right.
spent half his life in prison for a crime he didn't commit.
Well, we're reviewing the art form. Yeah, we're not reviewing his life or anything.
Yeah,
like
but we're reviewing the art form. So I liked it. Like Dalt said, though, it's sad that this isn't some crazy isolated mm-hmm. incident. You know, like, stuff, injustice happens every single day across this country and, you know, I mean, across the world, if we're being honest. But I'm not naive enough to sit here and think that there's not one justice system for white people and one for people of color. You know, I mean, you know, he was unlucky to be a young black kid in the wrong place at the wrong time when a white cop got killed. Mm-hmm. And everything that came down on him after that, you know, is just horrible. And it's good that we're able to live in a society where these sorts of documentaries can get made mm-hmm. that can shine a light on injustice. And yeah. we're not in just like some totalitarian regime where everything gets covered up and this is never going to see the light of day. But it's sad that this even happened in the first place. And the defense attorney, her name was Rosemary Scapiccio, mm-hmm. I think. She said a few times, and granted, she's a defense attorney, so she has an agenda, but she said, you know, if you're a prosecutor, your aim should be justice. Mm-hmm. And if you know that somebody spent even one night in prison for a crime they didn't commit and you put that person in prison, you shouldn't be able to sleep. And I'm like, well, you know, on the one hand, given the justice system we have, that's a naive view. But on the other hand, I mean, that's right. Like, it shouldn't be about conviction rates. It should be, you know, we want to find out for this cop's family mm-hmm. what happened. And whatever gets uncovered. And I'm sad about that, but at least we're going to have the correct people paying the price. Mm-hmm. We're going to know what actually happened, and the correct people are going to pay the price, as opposed to this poor kid who was in the wrong place at the wrong time, right. and we just wanted to pin it on anybody so we could cover up all the wrongdoings, mm-hmm. you know, of these crooked cops. And, you know, so, I mean, yeah, it's right. We have a real problem with the justice system in this country.
Well, and I thought her, I completely agree with the premise there that she's wanting justice and the justice system should be first and foremost concentrating on doing the right thing. But, excuse me, but I think that that's a little bit of a utopian perspective as well. And but as close as we can get to that as possible is the goal.
No system is perfect.
And plus, we were looking at in this from the early 90s, there was, you know, still obviously a lot of science that needed to be developed for forensics and that sort of thing that we have now that would make this case a lot easier to track down than it was in those days.
Well, I don't know. I mean, even there was like nothing that tied him to the crime scene at all, except for the fact that he happened to be at the same store buying diapers around the time the guy,
well, even
the cop
like,
got shot.
So even that, like closed circuit cameras, they didn't have any at the Walgreens. Yeah. They would have those now. You know what I mean? Like there are things that, there are advancements that have been made that would make this a little bit simpler.
Yeah, so it was the flimsiest of evidence. And then there was some witness intimidation to get people to testify against this kid.
Intimidation and also payoff too.
And payoff, so... Yeah, so
it was really interesting the way they did it too in terms of you're talking about the length and it was a little bit long to me like I said, but there some of the things that I really enjoyed about it were the teases. Like a good tease in a good book is for example, the character goes to the store and looks for something and then walks out and that's not part of the main narrative, but you're guessing as to what's going on there. And they did this kind of thing in the documentary so that there were certain things that were dropped in there that you were like, why did that happen? And then they come back to that later on. So they explain it. So if you're watching the first couple of episodes and you're like, this is not fully baked. This seems like a half-baked documentary. They actually do cover some things like the phone, like you were saying. They mention off the top about a woman maybe being in the car at the same time when the cop was murdered, but then they don't mention her until much later on. Mm-hmm. So you're almost like, did they forget about the woman? What's going on here? So there are some threads through here that make it very attractive to come back to and keep you enticed, which I think is, as the art form itself, you've got to have a documentary that pulls everything together at the end. I think that it does. I mean, I don't think it's any surprise to listener to know that the guy gets exonerated because he's in the interviews in the early going of the documentary. He's in street clothes. I mean,
yeah, he's driving around Boston. Like
he's not in his
jumpsuit.
Jumpsuit or his inmate suit, and he's not in the bright orange, and he's not in, you know, there's not bars behind him or anything like that. So you get the idea that yes, he's gotten off on this, but it's still. There's still suspense because you want to know what's going on. Why are there four trials? Why are we talking about this guy at all? So I think there was a lot of good stuff in there. I think it was a minor complaint, really, that it was too long. I think it was fine. I've got docuseries fatigue because, you know, a lot of the times we're eating up a lot of our day trying to watch these things. And it's not a complaint because there are a lot worse things going on in the world right now than watching documentaries at home. But I'm just, I'm looking for some new way of doing it other than the drone shots. And that's why I like the
American Murder.
The American Murder so much was because it was small or short, I should say. It was a big story told in a small way, but it had a lot of breadth and depth. There were some problems as we subsequently learned about the balance and everything like that to that documentary. But the fact that they used all this new footage from and used Facebook posts and they recreated it without really having any access to footage, I thought that was really good.
And Trial 4 is definitely your traditional documentary.
Yeah.
Like they were sitting down with the people were talking to the camera. Instead of doing recreations with actors, they did like anime recreations as opposed to American Murder, which had none of that stuff. It was just all like police body cam footage and footage from the interrogation room. And you know, Trial 4 did have, you know, like news footage from the time of like Sean Ellis's trials and stuff. But yeah, they interviewed Sean Ellis repeatedly. They interviewed all of his defense attorneys. They interviewed some jurors from the first couple trials.
Right.
You know, they shockingly did not interview any cops or DAs. They all declined to be interviewed for this docuseries.
I mean, that's a hole in this story, but I understand that they tried. At the end end of yeah. each episode, they said, here's the list of people that did not want to participate in this mm-hmm. Series.
And, I mean, all you can do is reach out. And right. if they say no, they say no.
And they do have a couple of cops in there. They had a couple of the main cops who were involved.
Yeah.
So there was their perspective.
And those guys are, I mean, they're just covering up till the end. They're like, this investigation is clean as the driven snow. Right. Like, there's nothing wrong with this investigation. And yeah. I'm like, well, if that's how you got to sleep at night, then... Sure thing, pal.
Well, that's the thin blue line, right? Like, that's yeah. where everybody, knowing some police officers in my life, I know how they can get defensive about that kind of thing. And it's what's happening here for sure. And but there has been, you know, the story evolves from a wrongful conviction into sort of like a social justice and also into a diversity aspect. So there's a lot there in terms of the problems that Boston has in the infrastructure and in its history, but also socially. And toward the end of it, you think a little bit more optimistically about it. I think you come out of it thinking, well, maybe there's a chance here. But it's a pretty wild ride. It's a good little ride, I think.
I hope that Sean Ellis has like sued the crap out of the Boston PD and the Suffolk County DA and just anybody whose name he can put on that piece of paper. Like, I just hope he sues the hell out of all of them, because anybody is going to take a look at like all this evidence and they're going to be like, yeah, this kid got railroaded yeah. and he lost 22 of the prime years of his life, like yeah. from when he was 19 to like what, 44 or whatever. Yep. So
yep. yeah, and I mean, stressful.
Yeah. I mean, he deserves everything that he can get from those entities. And his lawyer even said to him at one point, she's like, I don't like you being in Boston. You know, the cops are just going to be chomping at the bit to like pull you over for running a stop sign. Mm-hmm. You know, they're just looking for reasons to nail you. So she was really nervous about him being in Boston. And I understand that completely.
Well, and she was saying that too in relation to, do you want to take this any further? Do you right. want to get some compensation? Because yeah, all they have to do is the boys with the badges just pull them over, and then that case is dismissed or it has right. some sort of taint to it. So that right. it's a really difficult position to be, because he wants to live in his community, which is in Boston.
Right. All his family is there.
Everybody's there yeah. that he cares about. He wants to have a normal life. But at the same time, he's got to get something back out of this. You know, mm-hmm. if this actually falls the way it looks, then he served a lot of time for a murder that he did not commit.
Yeah. So,
which, you know, how do you pay somebody back for that?
Right, exactly.
How do you compensate them for, you know, years lost?
Yeah, he'd rather have those years back and have a family and have right. a stable job right. and just have his freedom. And he was talking about, you know, I know everybody jokes about like showers in prison, but he was saying like that was one of the hard things for him when he came out, when he got released on bail awaiting his fourth trial, when his conviction was thrown out, because in prison, you just want to get in and get out of the shower really fast. And you don't just stand there and like let the water wash over you if you've had a bad day or whatever. Mm-hmm. And you just get in and get out. And so when he went to like a halfway house or something, I guess, and they said, hey, take as long as you want in the shower, he was like, what? yeah. What? And that's just such a concept. It's like, wow, who, you know.
Well, and even the thing that underlined it to me was when his sister took him to vote.
Yeah.
And she was explaining as they were walking to the polling station how to vote. Mm-hmm. And then there's all these photos of him,
you yeah, know, with his
with
ballot.
A ballot and filling it out and not closing up, not a close up with what he was voting for or anything like yeah. that, but or who he was voting for. But that just struck me as how we take for granted a lot right. of these civil liberties that we have, and all these kinds of things were the things that were taken away from him. He wasn't allowed yeah. to vote in Massachusetts because of that. So, It's a heartbreaking story in so many ways, but I think these are the kinds of stories that are really important. I find documentaries compelling if they're done well, and this was done well. Again, I think it could have been shorter, but I give it like a gavel and a half up, probably.
Oh, wow. Yeah, I'd probably give it like in the B+ to A- range too.
Yeah,
also.
Yeah.
And listener, I know that I probably should not recommend other podcasts, but if you are interested in another story of a guy who was wrongfully convicted and railroaded, you should check out season 2 of the podcast In the Dark. It's about a man in Mississippi named Curtis Flowers who was tried six
oh, yeah.
times mm-hmm. for some murders back in, I believe, the 80s, like 85, 86, 87. I think he was convicted all six times, maybe, but at least 3 of those convictions were thrown out because the DA who tried the case was a white guy who intentionally kept black people off the jury because the guy he was trying was a black person. Mm. And so when the U.S. Supreme Court tells you that, like, you're so racist that it's obvious, then maybe you ought to rethink what you're doing. But yeah, so he was...
supposed to be a jury of your peers, right?
Right. And so finally, I believe in 2019, the U.S. Supreme Court threw out Curtis Flowers' last conviction, and the Mississippi Attorney General has declined to prosecute him a seventh time. So, and it just took a couple investigative journalists going down to Mississippi and interviewing old witnesses and coming up with like an alternate suspect. And yeah, so I highly recommend season two of In the Dark if you're interested in, not that this should be entertainment for anybody. I mean, these are people's lives. Like Curtis right. Flowers lost, you know, like 30, 35 years of his life in prison for right. crimes he didn't commit. But
the more we know about this kind of stuff, hopefully the greater the chance that it doesn't happen again.
Right. Like the more of a spotlight that is shown on these issues, the better.
Mm-hmm.
So
looks like we have a recommendation here for you, listener.
Yeah, Trial 4. Check it out.
Trial 4. So that's going to be it for another edition of the podcast. Thank you so much for joining us, listener. For another week, I'm not Coco.
And I'm not Dalton.